team and talks to families, raising care leaders. We have specialist mental health practitioners providing mindfulness and wellbeing provision. It's very, very broad-based, and we've got lots of different sound bites and video clips, so yeah, we'd be really pleased to do that. And if that's something that we maybe could build into the future meeting, that we would have to do that. Okay.
Thank you for that brief update. With the committee's approval, we'll get hopefully some participants from the programme to come and address us in person at the next meeting of the committee. We'll move on to item 5, and this is titled Capacity of Our Business Support in the City Region. Now, to give a bit of background, Capacity Lab is an independent organisation consultancy that in November made a number of policy recommendations for community business support in the Liverpool City Region. And I thought that those policy recommendations would be of interest to members of the committee and would be of interest to the committee as a whole in 3 months. So what I did is
Saturday tonight, and I looked to my right and I wondered whether or not Steve Beaker might consider sort of community business. But the report's never thought about that in broader terms. The list of the 30 community businesses that the report's spoken to, one of those was a credit union. We have lots of credit unions in the city and the city region. So why only one credit union? Have all the credit unions been into the community businesses? So there's some issues about definition. And there's also an issue in the report about, well, isn't community business by definition a wonderful thing? No, I'm not saying it isn't. I think we have to be careful about the concept. Because to some extent we will sit here and say food banks are wonderful things. But they're a response to poverty and austerity. And I think sometimes you see community businesses fall as a response to poverty and austerity. And whilst they are great in themselves, they can be reflective of deeper issues that maybe we should be demanding a broader government policy response to, not leaving this to local communities to have to try and resolve. So there are some broad considerations about the concept. In terms of the piece of work that other catalogs have then done, it's all perfectly reasonable to produce a range of responses that I think by themselves are fine. So I think if you went to go to any business in any sector, you'd almost have got the same set of responses about the sorts of business support that they would want. So is it reasonable then to look at those responses in isolation? Because you could sit here as members and say, we demand this sort of support for our community business sector. And if you did that, I think you'd then get a response from the wider social economy sector saying, how about us? Don't we deserve the same level of support? And maybe the private businesses say, well, how about us? Because we want that level of support as well. So there's a real danger of looking at the various recommendations, most of which are perfectly reasonable and supportable, but in isolation just from a community business perspective. For me, though, one of the things that the report missed out as a recommendation is that when you look at a report's acknowledgement of where most community businesses operate, they're very localised, they tend to be trading at a small scale, they tend to be cafes or cinemas or community centres, and those are bits of the economy that tend not to produce additional jobs. Not so they don't produce jobs, but if you set up a cafe, take that's a Shortall issue for, I think, perfectly good point about local economies. A high street will only be able to support so many local cafes. If you've got three instead of four, what you find is one of the other three eventually goes out of business. Or you have to be really, really careful about what you count as additional economic activity. And most of the national drivers for business support are about creating additional jobs, not jobs that will just be offset somewhere else in your economy. And that's one of the reasons why sometimes community businesses struggle to access some of the funding and some of the activity that actually would help develop community businesses, because they're not operating in the right sectors. And that implies either that community businesses should seek to operate in different sectors, or that there should be some specific government funding to help support community businesses. And that's a bit for me, if I have been the author of that report, one of the conclusions I would come to is actually community businesses do have a role in the local economy, but they're not necessarily about job creation. They're about providing support to local communities. They're about perhaps being the first step back into employment for some people through a volunteering route. And that for me would have been the argument about community business sector, about why you want to support it. And I think the report misses that. And if we were developing some policy around community business, if those are the bits of community business that you want to see support, and that be the rationale for why community business in itself is good and the right outcome, not from an economic business growth perspective. And I'll not be sure.
small sample bank, that's 37% of the overall businesses, so I think it's not particularly a small sample that they've looked at. And the other bit, I've just gone through it, the example that you've just given there about the cafe, none of that's evidenced in the report. To be fair, that's just what you think, isn't it? Because the evidence doesn't bring that up. And then the other thing was, on page 17, the top, where you say it would significantly benefit the business sector. Again, none of that's borne out in the report. And then I did some research myself, and community business is worth 180 million to the economy. So I appreciate to a degree what you say about the jobs don't come, and you know, although they're valuable, they're not particularly great for economic growth. But from my experience as a business growth advisor, I think the reason they don't develop and they don't probably grow like they used to is because they simply don't get the business support. And I can give the committee an example. Kensington Fields is a really important part of my board, and they're struggling with funding. They're struggling to be sustainable, and they were desperate to find help with a business plan. And they, you know, as I said, what they're trying to do, they've got brilliant ideas, great people. Now, I know they can get business planning help. That's when I went back to earlier to Bob and said, they don't know about these things, they don't know, so they'll never survive. So I do know that Power to Change has identified the city region as being perfect for Power to Change. So being close to these kind of businesses who I think form a big part of the economy, I think we should be trying to look to ways to support them. And I support what Patrick said earlier, because my contact at the community centre would be absolutely, I think, over the moon to come and talk to the panel and to the committee about what they do and the support that they need and why they're passionate about getting help from Power to Change.
Chair, I think in terms of the sectors or the type of activity that I referred to, I am basing that on what's in the report and the organisations that they talk to. The report specifically references the sort of area the community businesses tend to trade in. And I think how specific executive for that later on. My point about economic growth isn't a personal opinion, it's the drivers for national policy. And I'm not suggesting that community businesses don't have value, in fact, I think most of all, they do quintessentially. But the problem is that it isn't a value that national policy necessarily recognises. And therefore the sector struggles sometimes, I suspect, to actually engage with some of the funds, some of the activities that businesses that are producing high amounts of jobs or businesses that are clear economic growth can then access. So I'm not saying that community business should have that support. I'm saying the argument for community business is not necessarily a straight economic one. It's a community growth, community stability argument. And that's the bit that I think is actually missing from the report. That's a point earlier on. If I'd written the report, if I was the author of the Power for Change report, I'd be attempting to sell the concept of community business on that basis. And for me, that shouldn't come through the report.
Sorry, just quickly on that then. You do say it's a small sample, but it wasn't a small sample, it's actually quite a large amount of 30, isn't it, out of 80 businesses. I take on what you're saying, but then it only reinforces why we should be using the Growth Hub more often and to support the businesses, because I know when I did the Growth Hub job, we struggled with helping and directing these kind of businesses, or these, they are kind of businesses. So there is help out there for them. And as I said, I welcome the Chair's opportunity for us to invite people from the public to talk about the value they add to the community. I do think as well, they can produce, they can offer employment. They can, there is an opportunity. I just think that they probably need more help early on.
I don't know. small business, medium-sized businesses, do need help, especially in the first and second, and possibly even third year, in setting up. Everybody now on this table knows that there is some way, but there's that many businesses start up and fail in the first year. We all know that as well. Where do we get the money from to support all these failures? Again, if this is a dynamic, we all accept it's got to be done. But really, the government don't give a monkey's about it. They're cutting funds everywhere. We're trying to keep social services, we're trying to keep children's services, we're trying to keep everything else going. What are we going to cut to bring the money available to put the proper provision in? We're trying to keep the schools and the training on to get people trained up to do the jobs that the science and create, to give the services to make people get. We're in the dynamic, but it is, honestly, I don't know where we go. Yeah, we've got to do it some way, but we're going to make the cost to make the money available to do it.
Can I just respond to him?
No, I'll speak and then I'll bring it down. So, I think you've hit on the number, the point there. We've had 9 years of cuts to budgets, and quite rightly, we prioritise making savings which don't over affect people's frontline services. We've got a choice of whether you're going to cut adult social care or children's services, or are you going to cut the business advice that we're giving to potential entrepreneurs. Sadly, these are the hard decisions that are going to be having to make. And they've been made for 9 years, they're going to be continued to make with the Tory government for at least the next 4 or 5. I would love there to be council-funded business support services which will mitigate any of this decline of the high street that we all know is going on and will see an expansion of community business. I don't think it's politically feasible for us to say we're cutting as a social care, but we're prioritising business advice. If we can bring in additional ring-fence funding, I think if the cabinet member can look to see how that can be done, if that can be done, I think everybody on this committee table would agree with that and support that. I think it just speaks to the difficult choices that as councillors and as a local authority we're all about to make.
Chair, thank you. That's actually incredibly helpful because I think in drafting my response to the power change report, I believe the power change are actually lobbying us because we don't really provide business support. We don't have a budget to do that. The investment report team that came in house in April last year is 7 members of staff with a £12,000 budget to deliver anything else that they do. Everything else that team does is funded by external funds. And either it comes from the EU or it comes, whether it's written by the authority or not.
opportunity for debate in February. I think the issue though around small businesses having an impact on the economy, for me, but you know, it's great when you get big employers, but the reality is that in terms of businesses, there mainly are those small businesses, and we have a lot of them en masse, and that's where we will get our employment, and those community business and the wider social economy actually are going to be the anchors for our communities and the dire straits and that we need, and that they get the buy-in from the wider community. So for me, I do think we should be looking at how we can help, but absolutely, I accept your point, is where's the money coming from to do it? I think it is around the campaign and the to get that acknowledged by government and by European funds and whilst that's it. Thank you.
Just to be technical and boring, just for a second, if Maggie O'Carroll was here Thursday evening, you know, Maggie and I have had this conversation, both for the same side, but for about a decade. If you look, for instance, at ERDF funding for business support, it broadly rules out retail businesses because it conceives a retail business as being not a job creator. Because it says there's only so much money in your local retail economy. Now, it doesn't matter how many businesses you've got, you put another business there, it puts somebody else out of business. That isn't my opinion. That's the opinion of the funders. And that's my essential point here. That if I was writing this report, that's the essential thing that needs to change if you're a community business.
Can I also
sorry, I think I'm not going to sound like I'm going to be but just so I've got it really clear in my head, because how it's been mentioned, so 80 businesses that were sampled, roughly 80, they're from the Liverpool City Region, aren't they? I understand that some of those, the majority of those, I think, could trade across different areas, but is it about 12, 11, something like that, that are actually based in Liverpool itself? Just so I've got it clear in my head. When we're moving on to having that discussion about the socioeconomic benefits and thinking about businesses operating in a very local city sense, it just be good to get that clarification.
Sure, my understanding of the figures is that the report isn't entirely clear on some of the figures, and that's fine, it's a big report, there's a lot to take in there. But there's 80 community businesses in total in the report here. And the people who carried out the research have spoken to 30 of those businesses. Now, I guess my concern is there's lots of other organisations that might consider themselves community businesses who aren't included within that 80 number. I don't know, but I think about all the work we've done over the years working with community organisations that consider themselves community businesses. I can think of more than 18 in all of the city, let alone the city region. So it just feels like a very, very narrow definition that's produced a very narrow sample. And if the report writer knew who all the 80 businesses were, and that's all there was in the city region, surely the thing to have done would have been to have engaged with all 80, if that's the only number of businesses there were. But I think my point is there's probably more community businesses than the report recognises. And we've only spoken to a small number of those. And I'm going to take the point that we've made by colleagues in the social world, that the community business sector is a subsector of a much bigger social economy sector. It's about 6% of the social economy sector. So it's part of a very small niche of businesses. And if we wanted to really understand what the issues and drivers were, my view would be looking to have seen a larger sample, but for this sort of piece of work about more of a broader social economy field.
Right. Just quickly, it's with the business side of my brother and uncle. Around about the time I did
if you change the time from 3 o'clock close to open at all hours, I put around the corner, and Rudy said to him, we want you to extend your hours to open all things. He said, you'll lose money. He said, no, you won't. You're on the road from here, it'll be great. And he said, no, you won't. You'll lose money because there's only a certain amount of money in the area. They said, no, you open all hours. So he had to go along, otherwise he lost his job. Within 6 months, a pub that he ran was isolated. And in the area, it was fairly isolated. It's only one. Within 6 months, that pub was losing 10% of its income. Within 9 months, it was losing 25% of its income. Within 12 months, he moved out. Because what was happening was he used to, and he also lost staff as well. He got rid of staff because people used to have busy time. At past 1 till 3 o'clock, people come in and have a few pints. Maybe there's the staff to cope with. From 9 o'clock at night, half past 10, we got busy. We got extra staff in, we got busy. Once he started to open all day, that staff was there all day. He put two of them on full time. Instead of having 6 or 7 in the grand time. So his cost was down, but the income was down, and then it was a shortage of that. And then obviously supermarkets started selling. So there's a lot of other stuff that's in it. But his income in the home was vastly reduced. He moved down because he couldn't make a living out of it. He was an isolated pub, he didn't have competition. That was a business, and within 2 years that pub was shut. Because it's not just where you are, which was even isolated, and you think, it's the only pub in here that's making money. The hours were open all day. Lots of things influence what goes on. And that's a local community, yeah, lots of things going on. It's still been, it's shut after 2 years. It's just an example.
It's not
everything.
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's entirely unfair to sort of compare adult services and coastal businesses and say, you know, which one do you want? I think that's a bit unfair. We're going to have a balanced budget, and I was just spoke to the mayor just an hour ago, so I'm not worried about that. But I do have concerns, or I think we should look closely at stuff in terms of how we proceed further. I'd like more preemptive scrutiny in terms of this. You're right in terms of the matter being a different conclusion from powers of change, because it's a commissioned report to capacity lab to do other things. But I think I don't like giving hope, giving up on anything. I think there's still ways we can signpost, ways we can do things that doesn't cost the council any money. But what it does as act as a front door, because that's what happened in many ways, as a front door, or what a one point access point where everyone can go and knows it does. And we can do all those, we can still give that support at the minimum cost. I don't think we should write everything off, but you know, I take on board what you're saying.
I'm going to curtail the discussion there. We've had a good flow of going over the issues, I think, for the last 40, 45 minutes.
Yeah.
We can put the loads of lights for the rest of the night and start talking about what we will do if only we have the money to do it. I think, well, the discussion that we've had around the table, the cabinet member and officers
Just very briefly, the briefing note that you've got before you about pages 38 to 39 of your agenda pack sets out the publicly available information that we have at this time on the priorities, the employment skills priorities of the new government. Some of the information that was set out in the Queen's speech back in September, and then the rest set out in the manifesto. But the point would be to submit the report before Christmas. We hope that we thought that there may be some more information forthcoming that we could brief you on. Today, unfortunately, there has been no more information produced by the government. Government ministers and civil servants are still returning to work post Christmas. The report sets out the factual information that has been put into public domain, and potentially that's as much as we've got at the moment. I think we will be able to, completely use the committee, will be able to receive further reports as more information comes forward. We had yesterday the notification of the date of the budget in March, and I would imagine that there will be some further information forthcoming at that point in time. The priorities for the government are set out in briefing notes.